What's up, you guys? So I am here in Southern Florida, and boy, is this beautiful. This is some of the clearest water I've ever experienced, but Florida has been an amazing state, very elaborate, and hopefully I'll get to some fishing out here. They got all sorts of cool fish like snook and tarpon and barracuda and all sorts of different fishies, so hopefully I'll be able to snag a big one. But as you saw behind me, there is a bird. Now, there's a lot of birds around here, and a lot of them have these longer legs and longer sharp beaks. And they'll be pecking at the ground. They're getting little invertebrates and all sorts of little creatures and eating those up. So that's what they're built for. So it's just adaptation over the years have gave them certain body parts like the long beak and long legs to do that. And it's cool because the park actually supports sea turtles like a lot. You'll see signs all over the place, like little mesh places where you can't go because there's a sea turtle nest, or they got books and information on them so people know how to keep them safe and give you tips like, what are you doing, Mr. Bird? It's over by my stuff. But yeah, give you tips like turn off your lights at night so the sea turtles don't get disoriented. Oh, and another thing I've seen which is really cool is iguanas. Now, if you don't know what an iguana is, it's a very large lizard. Like, the biggest one I've seen so far is nose to tip of the tail is about this long or so, sitting up in trees. So, let's go exploring this beautiful water.
Oh my gosh, you guys. One really crazy thing about this place is you will not believe how warm the water is. It's almost hot. It's like a bathtub, perfect shower temperature. It's amazing. So it beats jumping in that Devil's River pond for sure, or river, because it's Devil's River. But yeah, I've seen like little creatures. I've seen little fish, little needlefish, little crabs, little shrimp, all sorts of things. And on the beach, I even found an old sea urchin. So it was that little like donut shape I had found when in South Africa. But yeah, so lots of really cool stuff here. And I'll see what other creatures I can find.
Okay, you guys, so I've got this cool little bug that I've been meaning to show you for a long time because we do have them in Texas. And even when we filmed the first episode, I could actually hear them all night through the tent. They make a chirping sound, and you might be able to hear it right now, but they can get very noisy. And the mystery bug is a cicada. Now, cicadas are very interesting. Their life cycle is pretty cool. If you have time, go check it out. But I'll just give you the short little part, summary. So what they do is when they're a little bug, they crawl out from their little house after a certain amount of time, and then they climb up on a tree and they hook their claws into the tree or branch or wherever, and they sit there and they sort of make a chrysalis like butterflies do, and the shell hardens, and then they once it's time to hatch, they'll pull all their body parts out and they will have big beautiful wings like butterflies. And so here's the little shell. This is just an exoskeleton of one. You can see, put it on my shirt and show you guys. You can see where he hatched out, that little gap right there, and he popped out. And here's the final copy. Six legs, looks just like this guy does. And he's kind of like a June bug. He's a clumsy flyer, and that's how I caught him. And I'm going to set him down in my shorts and we can see him fly away because he is being restless. Ah! Okay, there he is, you guys. Grabbed onto my finger. Ooh, I'm sure iguanas have an easy meal with these guys because they're pretty slow, like June bugs. Jeez. Come on, dude. Fly. Okay, I guess he'll just walk. So up here in this little tree area, there are lots of creatures as well that would normally be on the beach, which I just spotted one. But I'm going to show you this guy first. He is a hermit crab and he's just in a shell. Look at him go. But watch this, you guys. Look at this guy. So I just managed to capture a very large hermit crab, probably one of the largest I've ever seen, especially in the wild. But look at that beautiful shell. This guy does have some big claws that could pack a punch. I mean, look at those. Maybe stubby, but they sure are muscly. Now I'm gonna set him right side up. He's coming out. Funny little guy, he's got his whiskers. Oh, he hid. Oh, there's another one way back there you can see. But when you walk through here, you just hear all the leaves move because all the geckos are running and all the hermit crabs and all the iguanas, so it's a really cool little area with lots of dense wildlife. What if I just leave you guys right here with him? See if he can. Okay, guys, so I was about to go swimming, and there's a seriously big crab over here crossing the road. Look at that. My gosh, you guys. That is a very, very big crab. Don't want to get in his way. He's a huge fiddler crab. Oh, there's two of them. My gosh, look at that, you guys. Hello, mister. That's a humongous crab. Oh, my gosh. Look at the size of that claw. He's a huge fiddler crab. My gosh. That has to be the biggest fiddler crab in the world. Look at that, you guys. Wow, that's cool, isn't it? My goodness, it's crazy. See if I can get him to come out at all. I must have ran into a hole. I don't see him anymore, you guys. Well, that was cool. It's the first time I've seen a fiddler crab that big. And yeah, so now back to the beach. Okay, guys, so it's pretty late at night, and I'm here with my friend the cicada, and he's pretty cool because most cicadas, when you pick them up, they'll just try and fly away. This guy likes to chew with me because he likes me. And if you're really lucky, you'll hear him say, "Hi, Alec," but he doesn't want to right now. He's being lazy. Look at him crawl. He's just a happy little feller. He's not out there being noisy looking for mates. He's here chilling with his best bud, Alec J. Fisher.
Why don't you want to talk anymore?
Oh, come here. That's that hand. Silly bugger. He's attacking me, whatever the thing is. Oh God, I was holding him. Man, where are you going? You just keep walking. Do you have a destination? Or are you just gonna walk? There's some big steps you're taking. You aren't going anywhere. Silly guy. Why don't you want to talk anymore? You were just talking. Being silly.
Yeah, come here, baby boy.
Isn't he cutie? You aren't going anywhere. What are you doing? Look at that, you guys. He's trying to hold on, but not going anywhere. Oh, there you go. Okay, you guys, you want to see a magic trick? So my hand is empty, and I put it down, and here we go. I'm going to turn my hand around, and ta-da! Okay, I know you guys aren't impressed. See, I told you we shouldn't have done that act. What should we name this cicada? Name him Dilbert. Dilbert, what are you doing? Breakdancing. Come here, Dilbert. Dilbert, what's your take on life?
I don't know, Alec. I'm just a silly cicada that sits around all day. Some people say I sound quite like Morgan Freeman, but I have other opinions. I just like hanging out with you, Alec. I don't care about finding a mate like nature tells me to do. But it's okay, isn't it?
Yes, it is, Mr. Dilbert. Dilbert, where are you attempting to go? You're just moving in circles. No. Speedy, you sure have some grip. That was a pleasant night's sleep. Hello everybody, now it is a beautiful day in Key West and I am very very far south in the United States. Now I have traveled over 12,000 miles all around the United States to get to this destination. Now don't think that we're ending now because we still have some more adventuring to do. This is just like a little stopping point and yeah, so this is the whole reason that I traveled all the way around the United States is to get to right here. Now, you guys, what makes this even more special is that I am moving out of the country, and it was amazing to be able to tour this entire beautiful country, the United States, before I leave, because it might be a while before I come back, and boy, I have done stuff that a lot of people probably haven't been able to do, and I'm still only 13 years old. And it was amazing because I've hit almost every single state and hopefully one day I'll be able to say that I hit every single one. But you guys, tons of people have taken pictures and touched this sign before and I guarantee you am the only child that has been able to do this because of you guys. So thank you very much from the sincerity of my heart. I just can't thank you enough for doing what you did for me. And you guys, here we go. I'm gonna touch it. Now it's time for one of my favorite parts of being out and adventuring, fishing. Now, with saltwater fishing, there's always the problem of saltwater having an effect on your reel.
because it can clog it up and rust it so the spool won't spin. And also on your rig, for some reason, I know this must be like stainless steel or something, because these circle hooks really aren't rusting too bad at all. And if you have rusty hooks, you really don't want to use them because it can affect the fish and it can lose you a fish as well. And it can give you tetanus if it gets stuck in you. But I've got an average rig that I usually use in the surf of the Gulf of Mexico. Now, luckily, the Keys seem to have really smooth water, which is cool because then when I'm fishing in the surf, the waves don't come up and hit my reel, thus wrecking it. And if you do get salt water in your reel or on your rigs, you always want to wash it off with fresh water. And I've just got a pyramid sinker because when you cast out with a pyramid sinker, it does sink into the sand since it's pointed. Now, I'm starting to use circle hooks because it is more environmentally friendly with the way that you hook the fish. It causes less strain on the fish's mouth when you're reeling it in, and it's a better bait holder. I got my little tackle box right here. I've got some shrimp. And then in the very top, I've also got something that I haven't tried before, but I researched and found out that it's fairly good. Not that zipper. And it is something called a bucktail jig. Now, what a bucktail jig is just a jig, normal jig, with some fur on it, like a buck's tail, like a buck deer. And what you do is you just cast that out and you can pull it in different ways, just reel soft, like reel constantly, and it'll go through, or you can reel and then it hits the bottom and you jerk up and then all that, and then it's good for snook and tarpon and lots of other fish. So these little guys tend to work well, but this is one of the first times I've actually fished on a little kind of civilized type area with cement and all that, so we'll see how it goes. It is some deeper white water right off of here, and see how bad the current is. There's also rocks, so I gotta be careful with this bucktail jig. But you guys, let's test our luck. Okay, you guys, so I did manage to catch a fish. Now, this is my first Florida Keys fish, so it's pretty cool. Not as big as I was hoping for, but it still works, and I've still got more time to try and catch them. This is a type of snapper. Now, there are a lot of snapper in the area, but, and this is one of them. Now, yeah, it's very pretty. Got red fin there, got some red spots, green spots, a little neon blue stripe under his eye, got yellow eye and blackish stripe across, and he went after my average shrimp rig. I guess nothing can resist a dead live bait. And look at those teethers. You don't want to get nipped by him. But yeah, so it's probably about 5 inches or so, and he's gonna go back into the water. So say bye to Milton the snapper. Bye bye, Milton. It's a beautiful day in the Florida Keys, and it's nice and sunny. We've got some little bit of clouds to protect me from the hot sun. But I am in front of a turtle hospital, and as you guys know, the sea turtle is one of my 5 endangered species. So I'm gonna head in here and see how the whole process works of rehabilitating sea turtles. It's very important that these sea turtles do not go extinct, and they are a very beautiful species. So let's go see some sea turtles and see what everyone is doing to help increase the population. So, let's go. Thank you. here is the long key, and I am out in the flats, so you can see it's very shallow. You got my snorkel here, and just attaches to my goggles. I breathe through it when I'm swimming around. Now, fishing in the flats is very popular in the Keys. The big five of the flats are permit, snook, tarpon, bonefish, and one other one. Sorry, I can't remember. But they're very difficult fish to catch, but they're also very good finding fish. So we'll see if I can't have my luck with them. But first, I'm going to snorkel around and see if I can't find anything. So you guys are going to have to put your snorkel gear on and just hop in there. Okay, everybody, so it's nighttime out, as you can probably tell. What I am doing is looking for coconuts. Unfortunately, at this park, there is a rule where you cannot climb up the tree or throw a rock or anything to get the coconut down, so I'm just gonna have to find one on the ground. Now, coconuts is something I've wanted to show you guys how to harvest for a long time, because they're very fun, and it's a pretty wild thing to do. And guess what, you guys? I already found one, so I'm gonna keep looking for some with you guys. But yeah, so that green coconut is what I found. I found a green coconut. Now, the green ones aren't completely ripe, but they are still edible. They've got more water in them and some softer meat. The brown ones are the ones that lose the green husk because they are ripe then, and those are the ones you can buy at the store with the harder meat and less water. But in my opinion, I like the green ones better because I have had them before. But yeah, you guys, so I'll just show you how I'm doing this. I also gotta watch out for ticks because there are ticks here. So what you do is you gotta shake them to see if there's water in them. That one's empty, so it's pretty old. Must have got a crack or something. That one is too. What about this one? I can't feel any water in it, so I'm just gonna leave it. So there's where the coconuts fell from. There's a brown one. I think there's some water in it, but I like the green ones better. But yeah, you guys, so that's basically just what I'm doing. So when I'm able to harvest it, it might be in the, or open it, because it might be in the morning, because it's pretty late now. Okay, you guys. Hold on, you guys. I'm going to grab another coconut. Now, this one right here is a bit older because it is more brown. Old coconut husk can be used for fire starters. And the coconut water can be used to drink if you're on a saltwater tropical area, because that's typically where coconut palms will grow. And then the meat also has nutrients and carbohydrates and electrolytes and everything in it, so it's good for you. Not that much of a smell. But when I was picking them up, I was shaking them to see if there's any water in them. And how this works is the more ripe ones will get meat and more flavor in them, and then the newer ones, which you can still eat, but they have a little bit more water, and the more meat they get in them, the more flavor they have. So you don't want one with just pure water, because it's not going to be very tasty, but it will be hydration if you're in a survival situation. It's always good. Okay, so one little chunk's out, you guys, making progress. this coconut is from the wild. So typically when they harvest coconuts, they will peel off the husk, which is what I'm doing. They probably have machines or something to do it, because obviously this one not to be very easy to do with tons and tons of coconuts to send them out to big grocery store chains and all that. But yeah, so they husk them, and on the inside is gonna be the nut, which kind of looks like a face with three holes on it. Get to that later. But that's what you see when you go to the store. And those ones tend to be probably the most ripe. The meat is kind of tough. Now I have resorted to using my bigger knife because it is a lot more productive and progressive than my smaller knife, because my smaller knife doesn't pack as much of a punch. Thus I have to hammer it in with a coconut. Ooh, it smells really sweet, you guys. So here's our coconut. This half has got some meat on it. This is actually a pretty ripe coconut, actually. And here is the milk. I'll show you guys. It's got a little bit of stuff in it, but it's still good to drink. It's coconut milk or water. It's actually clear, I think. But here goes the taste test. It's really good. Kind of warm, but it's really good, you guys. And now I've got to get all the sand off my hands and try a little piece of the coconut meat. And I'm going to take my knife and clean it off. Just tip of the knife. And the skewer. Okay, so here's a piece of the meat. Tastes like coconut. So that was a success, you guys. Hopefully you guys will be able to get a coconut someday and try it out for yourself. Hello everybody. Now you might see a sea lion next to me, and you are not dreaming. There's actually a sea lion next to me. I am here in Dolphin Cove in Key Largo, and I am next to Wono the sea lion. And isn't she beautiful? She's very nice. Very friendly sitting here. She is a very intelligent creature, and she's, hello. And then there are two other pups. Oh, thank you. And there are two other pups here as well. Now the cool thing about those pups is they are rescues, and what happened is there was a certain course of events in nature, so the mother wasn't able to get the certain amount of nutrients that she needs to keep her pups healthy and happy. So either the mother died or she had to abandon her pups, and the pups were taken in. They were fed because they were malnourished, that's it. They were given their vitamins and everything, and they were released, and then they were rescued again because they weren't making it out in the wilderness, and they were deemed unsuitable to be in the wild. So they had to be taken in, and now they are here for educational purposes, and they are used to help people learn more about sea lions and respect the wonderful creatures. There's a few differences between sea lions and seals. Now, sea lions tend to have a uniform type color, like it's pretty much the same throughout the entire coat. And seals will have more of a pattern, like maybe different color splotches around. And seals have big bellies, and they kind of bounce on their belly to move around, where sea lions actually use their flippers to walk around. And seals also swim with their back flippers, as sea lions will mainly use their front. And one of the biggest differences is the ear flaps. Now, the sea lions have external ear flaps, where seals just have little holes where their ears are. So there's quite a few differences. Let's just a few to tell the difference between these guys and seals.
Sing a dance.
Tappers?
Beautiful. Good girl.
High five. And now, let's go check out some dolphins. Even though the wild adventure was really wild and super awesome and I'd love to keep doing it, everything that's awesome does come to an end. Now, I have found my ticket out of here and it is going to be my arms and legs, and behind me is the ocean. Thank you guys just so much for everything. I've had tons of amazing opportunities and you guys have been so supportive and you're just all so awesome. But you guys, you know what's out there? An entire world to be discovered. So, you guys, stay warm!